Oh, konnichiwa, minasan. It's me. Welcome back to another video. Now, I wanted to make this video before, but I wasn't sure if it was the good idea. But then I made a little bit of a video like this in another video. What the hell am I talking about? We're gonna travel all across the world from Tokyo to back to Sweden. Let's go. In case this wasn't obvious, or for some reason you didn't know, my core value, I am Swedish. That's right. That's why I'm so goddamn attractive and so goddamn, what's a bad Swedish trait? Cooked. So I grew up in Gothenburg. It's the second largest city of Sweden on the west coast, which means we get all the delicious fish, which is why I like fish so much, because we get the good fish. Over here in Stockholm, bad fish. Over here, Gothenburg, very good fish. I tell you about fish. You wanted me to tell you more about fish? I am becoming extremely Swedish. I think the thing is here is that I have not been back in Gothenburg for, I don't know, like 8 years since I went on this YouTube journey. I have not been back to Gothenburg. It's really strange. The f*** is that on the road? It's almost a bike helmet. Where should we go first?
Oh, I think I know now. I think I grew up like at the very top of one of these buildings. I don't remember anything from it, so I don't even know why I'm bringing it up.
All I can remember from this time is that I sucked on pacifier for way too long. Good times, good memories. When I was a kid, I had this really weird tic. Like, for me to sleep, I would suck on, not my thumb like normal people, I would suck on my finger and wiggle my hair. But the weird part about it was that I thought it was so great that I wanted other people to know how great it was. So I remember telling other people, like, no, listen, what you need to do is you need to suck on your finger and wiggle your hair back. It's the greatest thing ever, okay? You're missing out. You don't understand.
Maybe there's a weird gay undertone here that I was not intending for. Okay. Yes. This f***ing road. I would walk home every day from school. It's so goddamn long. These are really pretty houses. I remember my mom didn't want me to go to like one of the local schools. She wanted me to go to a really good school in the center. So I had to go home from school pretty far. I remember it was really far. But my mom got me and my sister a cell phone when we were like 5 years old or something like that, which was back in the day when they had those giant brick phones, just in case something happened. But I did have to travel pretty far to go home from school and walk up here. But I remember it was also kind of weird because when you're in school in the center, like a far, far away school, you don't really get that many friends in your own neighborhood. Classmates just lived all across Gothenburg. And I remember there was one point where my parents were like, it's Saturday, why don't you go out with friends? But I'm like, all my friends are super far away. And then I was just go out. And I'm like, I don't have any friends, Dad. What do you want me to say? This sounds more sad than it is. But I remember there was a time in my life where I'm like, I actually don't have any friends. Is anyone surprised? And it was so shameful. Like, I didn't want to tell my parents, but like, in retrospect, they make total sense. Like, this is a thing I understand later, because it was so shocking to me, this revelation. Like, I don't have any friends at all. But yeah, I already showed this in the last video. This is the house I grew up in. This is the school I went to. It's called Lilla Samskola. It's where all the privileged kids went to school. And I really appreciate my mom putting me in a really good school. Namaste, Mom. Even though it did come with the price of not having any friends. I can't really see anything. I don't know why I want to look into the school like some goddamn creep, but I don't remember much. Except one time there was a legendary snowball fight between two schools over here. Because all the kids from this other school, they came over and we had a legendary snowball fight over this fence. Legendary. It was like the Battle of Normandy, basically. I remember we also used to call like all the other kids like intruders. And we had to have this big meetings about not calling each other intruders. Very Swedish, very nice. I also remember someone pulling the fire alarm and we had to have a meeting too. And the principal, we were like 400 people in a room, and the principal stands up and be like, can the one that pulled the fire alarm please come forward? And like, obviously they're not gonna do that in front of 400 people. Like, yeah, it was me. I'm sorry. It wasn't me, by the way. Okay. It wasn't me. There was also I don't know, for some reason, this is where you entered the school, and there was like a lady that you had to say hi to. I don't know why. Is that a Swedish thing? I can't tell. She was nice. Don't get me wrong. Oh my God, they still have these squares. I can't believe they still have the squares. God bless. The squares were the best game ever. I don't know if you guys had this in school, but you had a basketball, and we call it king, but it probably has some other name for you. But basically, there was the king in one square, and then there was the queen, and then there was the two pawns. And you start off as a pawn, and then if someone obviously gets out of the game, you move up until you become the king. So basically, the way you play was that the one that was king could make up the rules of the game. So as soon as you become king, you're like, okay, the rules are X, Y, and Z, like, and you could just make up any rules whatsoever, which was, I don't know, that's what just made it fun. You could be like, okay, you lose if the ball bounces in your court, and then you just go, blah! And then a lot of times what you would do is that you would come up with a pact with the queen. So you would just work together to eliminate everyone else so no one else could beat you, which led to a lot of scumbaggery. I remember like a lot of bullying. We would just target. I wasn't a bully, okay? But we would target just like specific people and be like, oh yeah, this person can't play. I don't know. People would get so upset over this game. I remember people leaving, going outside the school, which wasn't allowed, just because they got so mad over playing this game. So it makes me really happy that people still have this god-awful game. I hope that's what they're still playing. Good times, good memories. Oh god, here's a football court. One thing you need to know about Sweden is that we're not very good at football, but we still love football, okay? I remember every goddamn gym class, people always wanted to play football. And our gym teacher was, I didn't like playing football. And my gym teacher would always go, hey, who wants to play football this game? Who wants to play football in this gym? And everyone's like, yeah, me. And it's just me in the back going, yeah, me, and let's play football. I hated gym class just because we always played football. Any other game, I'm totally fine with. But it was always football. But I wasn't good at football. I didn't like playing football. I hate football. I still hate football. Listen, people, you know, the classic, oh, pick you and blah, blah, blah. You get picked last. The thing is, what's worse than being picked last is being picked out of the assumption that you're actually good at football. Okay? Everyone's like, oh, I was always picked last in football or whatever, whatever. Okay? Boo hoo hoo. I don't have time for you. But what's even worse is when people pick you early. Like, I remember I was sometimes like the second pick. And then people would just realize I actually suck at football. And then they would reinforce this thing that I already know. Hey, you really suck at football. I fucking know. And then you're picked last. Huh? How do you think that feels? It doesn't feel good. I hate football. Stupid football ruined my life. Great times. I have fantastic memories from this school. It was great. I loved it. I really, really loved it. Then when you're in seventh grade, you go to this school, which is the same school. This is a lot bigger. I remember how massive and overwhelming this school felt like when you first started at it. They better not be playing football! If you play Brännboll, I was really good at Brännboll, okay? But no one was being stupid. Stupid sports. Sweden's not even good at football. It's stupid. If you are from Gothenburg, I know everyone's judging me right now because everyone hated this school because all the privileged kids went to this school or whatever. Yes, I was. But I also had to work for what I got. Like, we'll get to it eventually. I don't know how much I want to tell you guys. Should we just skip the high school days? They were not great days. Anyway, during my late teens, I really became very introverted. I didn't really care about interacting with that much in school. I just wanted to go home, play video games. I'm sure a lot of people can relate to this. All I really cared about was playing video games. I think that was what was on my mind when I was in school. I just was thinking about what I was going to play when I actually got home from school. And school just kind of felt like a prison these days. And I think a lot of people probably saw me like as a loner type because I didn't interact with that many people as well. Because it didn't really bother me to be alone as well. At all. I remember some people pointing out, like, why are you walking alone and stuff like that? I'm like, I don't know, I don't care. Based on that, it's like, I assume people probably thought I was pretty weird. But I did have good grades still. The thing is, like, I went to this really, really nice school where everyone is generally very nice to each other. The last 3 years of school, you need high grades to get into, to keep going in this school. And I didn't have good grades. And then we looked at other schools. We had like a day where we got to visit other schools and I just saw how awful they were. And I'm like full panic mode, but like, I need good grades because I don't want to go to a normal school. with normal kids, which I don't know if that was good or bad, but yeah, I got into it. Then I got into university. I went to Chalmers University of Technology. Where is it? There it is. Good old Chalmers. Out of all their like forks in my life, I think this is the strangest one to look back on. Because I think my life could have taken a completely different road depending on what, like small decisions, very small decisions would have made a massive significance, I think, in my life, which is kind of scary looking back on. The thing was, when I applied for Chalmers, I actually wanted to study architecture, or maybe, I think there's a course called art design or something like that. Like a bit more creative, but still logical type of professions or educations. And I think that really suits me because I think that's how I work. But I never thought I would get in because I think you needed one of the highest averages. Basically, I didn't think I would get in. So I just applied to the same course that my parents went to, which was a little easier to get into, but still really hard and still a really, really good course. But the thing was, I got way better grades than I thought, and I actually would have gotten into my what I actually preferred to go to. But the thing was, I didn't apply to them as my first choice because I was like, I should probably just go here. I won't get into the other ones anyway. And I just kind of went with it. I didn't really question it. And the thing was, like, what happened then was I went to this course in Chalmers that I didn't really want to go to, which just led to me eventually just hating it. I couldn't relate to my classmates. I felt like even more solitude than I was in high school. I just felt like a total outcast. I couldn't, just day one, it was just really hard. At this time as well, since I got into this school, my parents were so proud of me that they let me stay in my own apartment as well. I still had to pay rent for it, but I had an apartment at the bottom floor in here. And I would walk to university and I just absolutely dreading it. Just awful about going. It was definitely I think this was probably the worst part of my life. I got into the school, but I hated it. And if I had quit, then I would basically have nothing going for me. So it was like not even an option. But it also felt like, is this what my life is going to be? I'm just going to have to be around people that, you know, they were nice people, don't get me wrong, but that I didn't really feel like I could relate to at all. You know, I always had a passion for video games or whatever, but it was always like the nerds play video games or whatever. There was a few selected group of people that weren't nerds but still played video games, as in like we would still go to parties and we would still hang out, but in our spare time we like to go to net cafes and like that. But if there's one thing I regret from my childhood, is like I wish I just embraced what I enjoyed is totally fine and not just like pretend like I'm someone else to fit in a certain group, because then I think I wouldn't have gone into this I don't know, it's hard to say. Obviously I hated going to class so much that I would, instead of just like going to class, I would just walk around and do nothing. It's really weird. I remember it just being the worst part of my life. It was so lonely. I felt so outside and lonely. It was really tough. I gotta say, like, that it was a tough time where I didn't really know what I was doing, basically. Instead of going to school, I bought a computer and stayed home. And that's when I started to make these YouTube videos, because I've been watching other people do it. And I thought, hey, that's pretty cool. I can probably make videos. This was probably back in 2010, I think. 2009, even. I had also applied for another job, just like as a another resort. It was creatively related because I really enjoyed doing Photoshop and stuff like that. It just felt a lot more fun and exciting compared to the school that I was going to. It didn't feel creative at all. And I realized that I was actually enjoying a lot more being creative. And that's why I was doing a lot of these Photoshop stuff in my spare time. And I really loved playing around in Photoshop, making artwork and that kind of stuff. And I was getting a lot of joy out of that. And I thought, okay, well, maybe that's a career path that I want to pursue instead. But I think it was between me and another person, and I didn't actually get the job. They told me afterwards that it was me or this person. And I just realized in retrospect, I mean, if I had gotten that job, my life would have gone on a completely different career path, and I probably never would have gotten into YouTube. That's kind of my point. And then when I was hating going to university so much, you know, if I had just applied to my first choice, which would have been a more creative profession or a field of study, I think I also wouldn't have gone down to making YouTube videos because I would have just kept going with that career path. But since I hated doing school so much, I hated this study that I was doing. I felt like I'm in a terrible path. Yes, maybe if I finished this school, I would actually get a great job because it's a really prestigious school or whatever. But I just couldn't get through it. And I felt so incredibly trapped and so lonely. And I'd never interacted with anyone. And I just started making YouTube videos and sheer desperation and hope that I could at least have something else. And obviously, it got to a point where I just felt I can't even keep going with, even though I think I had like a couple thousand subscribers, like maybe 15 or 20,000 subscribers, which was, you know, it's pretty small number, but it felt like a lot to me. And I felt like, I can't keep going to this school. I just hate it too much. There's no way. I need to take a year off at least. And then my parents, they obviously weren't happy about this, which is fully understandable. So they said, well, you can't stay in your own flat anymore, which is totally understandable because I've been telling my parents, well, that I was passing my exams when clearly I wasn't. So I had to move back to my parents. And then they told me I had to get a job. And they were basically like, oh, good luck getting a job. You're never gonna get a job. And I just went, ha, I'll prove you guys. So I got the first job I could ever get, which was working at this hot dog stand. It was basically like one of these. I would make hamburgers, hot dogs. I would basically, sometimes I would even see like people from my class in the stand. It's like, hey, so you're here now. You're not in school anymore because you're serving hot dogs. That's great. Good for you. But it was strange because at this time I was actually so much more happier because I didn't have to go to school anymore. And even though it was a job, I was making money. I was making YouTube videos in my spare time. I was loving it. I was, even though I had a smaller channel, the support that I was getting on it was incredible. And I remember, you know, I have this video where I talk about 100 subscribers and I'm so happy that I got 100 subscribers. And I actually say in the video, like, oh, I'm not making YouTube videos to become famous or whatever. And I meant that, but it might seem weird to say that at 100 subscribers, like, oh, I don't want to be famous or anything. It's like, yeah, you have 100 subscribers. But the reason I felt like that because a lot of people treated me like I was going to become really big on YouTube. Ever since the beginning, people were so like, whoa, you're going to be, people felt like I had a special voice, I think at least. And that really gave me a lot of passion and motivation to pursue YouTube, even though my channel was pretty much insignificant. As soon as I played Amnesia, the horror game, in my little flat, this is before I got kicked out, that's when I knew I was onto something because people just was begging me to make more videos. And I was just screaming in the middle of the night in this tiny little flat. I wonder what the people upstairs were thinking. Then I got my partnership so I could make money out of my channel, and I didn't have to work at the hot dog stand anymore. I just been pursuing it since then. It's just like been a journey ever since. It's just insane looking back how my life could be so different, but I'm so grateful I had to have this experience and this journey. That's it. I kind of became a rant about my YouTube journey, but this is where I grew up. This is the tit city. Then obviously I met Marzia. And we stayed in Italy for a while, but then we decided to come back to... Oh, this is so much easier. Now I see. We decided to come back to Sweden, to live in Sweden for a while. And I was making money off YouTube, but my channel was still very small. It hadn't blown up yet when I was with Marzia. And so we couldn't afford living in the actual city. It was too expensive. And for someone that grew up with like a nice... and I was growing up in the, like, my parents had money, obviously. So it was so humiliating for me to have to live in the suburbs. I had to live in Partille, which I always used to make fun of people for living in Partille. Then I live in Partille, but to be honest, we love living in Partille. I think me and Marzia really treasure our days living there. Ah, yes. These are the buildings. The famous, ugliest building in the whole world. We lived in one of these. I can't say for sure which one. I think this one. And it was a tiny flat with a tiny desk. But the thing was, oh yeah, this is like a graveyard down here. But the thing was, like, down here was this huge shopping mall. So it was actually pretty convenient to live in one of these, even though they weren't very good. And I remember I could barely afford paying rent at this point. Like, it was even living in the suburb, and it was really tough. But we managed to get through. And like I said, me and Marcia really treasure still living in this period in Partille. We actually loved it. We also got our dog Maya while living in Partille, and because we just found, we wanted to get a pug, and we just searched, okay, where can we buy a pug? And there was someone here, somewhere nearby that we could actually get to. And then they had Maya, which only had one eye, so she was cheaper. So that's why we were able to get Maya. she's our budget dog. So a lot of great things came from that time. Then obviously we moved to UK, which is another chapter. And I think this video has gone on well long enough already. So thank you for watching this video. Smash like if you thought it was interesting, and I'll see you guys next time. Bye.
Tuber Simulator is now so relevant that it's got a brand new minigame, Craniac. Drop the crane and get fresh items only available in the washing machine-like game. And you say there's more? Of course there is! New knowledge perks, new quests, and new pixelings, and legs. Guys, legs.